Tales from the Crypt. Ernie visited the doctor, but never expected the last laugh.
Ernie shifted uncomfortably on the leather chair in the doctor's waiting room. From time to time, the expression on his loose, flabby-featured face would change from one of anxiety to that of a cheerful grin, and he would chuckle silently or laugh out loud. When that happened, he would clutch his stomach, and the grin would fade, and then anxiety would return once more. He shook his head. Sadly, after his most recent outburst of hilarity, and looked up with relief as Dr. Falder entered.
I'm sorry I kept you waiting, sir, but I've been having personal difficulties at home. Your call seemed urgent. What seems to be the trouble?
It's my stomach, Doc. I got pains. It hurts me here every time I laugh.
Dr. Falder slipped out of his overcoat.
All right, let's take a look at you. If you'll step this way, Mr. I'm afraid I didn't catch the name.
Seely, Doc. Ernie Seely. I'm new around these parts. Been in town about 2 weeks.
The doctor led Mr. Seely into his examination room and rolled up his sleeves.
I might as well give you a thorough going over, Mr. Seely. While I'm examining you, you can tell me about all this pain you've been having.
Started last week. I must have strained myself.
Or something.
The doctor bent over the sink and began to wash his hands.
Strained yourself? Mr. Seely, how? Oh, if you please remove your shirt.
Sure, Doc. Yeah, that's what I figure happened. You see, Doc, I go for yaks.
Doc Falder looked at Ernie quizzically as he dried his scrubbed hands.
Go for yaks, Mr. Seely? I don't understand.
Yaks, Doc. Laughs. Large charges. I get a bag out of jokes. Practical jokes.
The doctor slipped into his white lab coat.
Oh, I see.
And last week I nearly died laughing. I pulled his gag, see, and I figured I strained myself laughing over it.
Ernie stood before the doctor, stripped to his waist. The examining room lights reflected on his obese body. Doc Falder placed his stethoscope to his ears.
So you're a practical joker, eh, Mr. Seely? What sort of practical jokes?
You know, Doc, stuff like I call up a number, any old number, some night, and I say, this is the electric company, madam. We're checking on the street lamps in your area. Would you kindly look and see if the street lamp outside your house is lit?
Of course, hold on, please.
So the sucker goes,
see?
And when they come back, they say,
yes! The street lamp outside my house is lit.
Well, be sure to put it out before you go to bed, huh, honey? Bye.
Ernie began to laugh uproariously.
They fall for it every time, Doc. Hey, that ooh, it hurts.
Breathe deeply and hold it. The doctor moved the stethoscope about Ernie's chest, listening grimly.
All right, exhale. Go on, Mr. Seely.
All right, call up a candy store. And I say, Rosie's Candy Store, you got Philip Morris in a car?
Yes, sir.
Well, let him out, huh? His dinner's getting cold.
The doctor folded away his stethoscope as Ernie guffawed heartily again.
Stuff like that. What a riot.
Ooh. Oh.
And last week, you say it was last week, you seem to have strained yourself? Doc Falder wrapped the blood pressure bag around Ernie's arm. Ernie nodded, grinning.
Doc, last week, I pulled the greatest, the goddess, the best yak I ever pulled. I tell you, I nearly died laughing.
And what was that, Mr. Seely? Ernie started to chuckle.
I get this idea, see? I noticed that the kids in the burg all play down by the railroad tracks. And I noticed that the limited shoots through, doing about 70 every day at noon. So last week, I buy me some hunks of horse meat, real cheap stuff, big and raw and bloody, and I'd buy me some kids' clothes, and I stuff the meat in the kids' clothes, and I go down to the tracks about noon, and I lay the mess on the tracks near where some of the kids is playing. And I wait, and when a limited shoots by, I scream, "Yeah!"
Hey, what was that? Somebody screamed.
Doc, you should have seen the faces on those kids. They took one look at the gory mess and they started running in all directions.
Golly! Gee!
And he clutched at his stomach, wincing and giggling alternatively.
Honest, Doc, I nearly died laughing. You could have seen their faces. Soon the whole town come out. It took them maybe 3 hours before they found out it weren't no kid that got killed. Sirens and ambulances running around like crazy.
And you laughing? Dying! Wait here, Mrs. Seeley. I'll be a moment. Doc Fowler left Ernie alone in the examination room. After a few moments, he came back with 4 capsules in one hand and a glass of water in the other. Here, Mr. Seeley, swallow these, you know?
Well, what's wrong, Doc? Will I be all right?
Ernie took the capsules and swallowed them. You'll be fine, Mr. Seeley. And now, I want you to go out into the waiting room and sit down. I'll call you when I'm ready. I want to perform some tests on you.
Sure, Doctor, sure.
Ernie went out into the waiting room and sat down. He could hear Dr. Falder moving equipment around behind the closed examination room door. Just relax, Mr. Seeley. I'll be ready for you shortly.
Okay, Doc.
15 minutes went by. Ernie began to grow impatient. 20 minutes. Ernie felt a funny, piercing pain in his stomach. 30 minutes, finally. I'm ready, Mr. Seeley. Will you come in now?
Doc, something's happening here. It hurts. Ew, when I don't laugh now.
Ernie followed the doctor into the examination room once more. Get completely undressed, Mr. Seeley. Save your shorts. And while you're doing that, listen to what I have to say.
Okay, Doc. But see what you can do about these new pains I got now. Huh?
The doctor nodded grimly. Watching Ernie's disrobe, he began to talk. There was a family in this town, Mr. Seeley. A mother, a father, and 2 children. Boys. 1, 8. The young one, 3.
Can't stand kids. Boy, you should have seen their faces when they saw that bloody mess.
One day, the mother sent her 2 boys out to play. She told the 8-year-old to watch the 3-year-old and keep him out of mischief.
Say that Stevie doesn't get himself dirty, Jeffrey.
Yes, Mama.
But the 8-year-old wandered away, left the 3-year-old, disregarded his mother's wishes, and the 3-year-old got all muddy playing where he shouldn't have.
Oh, Stevie, just look at you.
The 8-year-old went to play with his friends. He'd completely forgotten about his little 3-year-old brother until he heard a blood-curdling scream.
Hey, what was that? Stevie!
Jeffrey thought that the bloody remains lying upon the railroad tracks was his younger brother, Stevie. Fear clutched at his little 8-year-old heart. He started running home wildly. He never saw the truck.
Ma! Ma!
Look out!
The mother rushed out of her house when she heard her older son's shriek of pain and the squeal of the truck's
brakes. Jeffrey! My baby!
In her frightened anxiety, the mother thoughtlessly left her 3-year-old son in the tub where she'd been bathing.
Yeah.
Ernie stood disrobed before the doctor, staring at his wide, flaming eyes.
You?
Yes, Mr. Seeley. That was my family's story. The 8-year-old died from being struck by the truck. The baby drowned. My wife dropped dead of a heart attack. Doc Falder's grip was like a vice of steel as he tied Ernie Seeley to the examination table. You say you almost died laughing over your practical joke, Mr. Seeley? Well, now you will die laughing. Those capsules I gave you contained fish hooks, barbed little fish hooks.
No, no!
Dr. Falder rolled out the equipment
he prepared and centered about the strip reclining figure of screaming Ernie Seeley. Then the doctor turned all of the equipment on, and the feathers tickled the soles of Ernie's feet and nudged his ribs and under his arms and behind his ears. Die laughing, Ernie! Die laughing!
No! No!
And so we leave Ernie Seeley with the little fish hooks in his quivering stomach, knowing full well that the doctor will make sure Ernie gets the point of this gag. Bad points. In fact, Ernie, this last yak will kill you. And now, the old witch awaits with her kettle of crawly creek cookery. Bye now. Oops, Ernie just had his last belly laugh. Real rib tickler busted his gut. He did. Bye.